All right, hello everyone. I'm Lander Visterin. I've been working as a software architect at Clario for a while now, working on this data policy project. And yeah, most of you here are also probably here because you're interested in getting your security in a better state, or yeah, maybe you're interested in open policy agents itself. But yeah, so the goal of this presentation will be to cover how you would implement open policy agent in your system and why you would do something like that. So to start with, let's go over access control in general. So when we talk about access control, there are really two important aspects that come into play. So the first one here is authorization. So that's really only about what someone can do on a certain resource. So that's about the definition of the rules and the enforcement of these rules. So completely separate from that, there is authentication, which is concerned with who someone is. So that's your SSO, that's your multi-factor authentication, things like that. So authorization builds on the premise that you have an authenticated user and you want to know what they are allowed to do or not. So when we talk about authorization, you could split it up in different kinds of models. So one very simple authorization model is an access control list that we all maybe know. So one example of this is you have like your Slack channel that might be set to private, and you manage a whole list of people that get access to that channel. And when someone joins, you have to individually add them to every channel, which may get kind of painful after a while. So that's why they invented role-based access control, RBAC. So in this model, you start grouping users together and managing those users as a group. So you might have a GitHub organization with some repositories in it that have your developers group added to it. And when someone joins, you just add them to that group and they will get access everywhere they need to. So, but this model also kind of has its limitations since you're only working with groups. So that's where attribute-based access control comes in. And yeah, it's a bit of an abstract example here. But the main idea is that, imagine a bouncer that's guarding an entrance somewhere. And to decide whether they let someone in or not, they don't just look at their credentials, whether they're valid, whether they're in a correct group. They look at all kinds of attributes before you can enter. And they also look at attributes at of the resource itself. So is there enough space, for example, to enter? So this bouncer is an example of an attribute-based access control system. So it might be a bit far-fetched. Another example you could give is just that's typically used is a user trying to access some resources. And they are in the correct group. But you also want to make sure that they can only access resources in their own location. So the user's location would be an example of something that's an attribute of that user. So attribute-based access control can kind of be considered a superset of RBAC and ACLs, which allows you to express more things. This is a lot more granular, but I say here it's easier to maintain, which is true. But it's also a bit harder to implement rather than a simpler model like RBAC or ACLs. So now that we have covered some general access control models, let's talk about decoupling a little bit, which is also in the title of this presentation. So why would you decouple your policy from your application code? Well, you might have scenarios where your policy applies to more than just one application. That's something we have actually run into in the real world. We've had a platform with lots of applications running on it, and they all were lacking access control in some way or another. I mean, they were secure, but the access control wasn't granular enough for the new requirements. So this is like a case where it really pays off to build one access control system and start reusing that in every place. So it's if you need to add more features to it, you can also build them once. Like if you want to build a UI on top of that, for example. So if you were to implement something like this, We can reason about different parts of our architecture as certain policy, blah, blah, blah points. That's a very common lingo used for these kinds of systems. So to start with, we have a very simple scenario where you have an end user that's already authenticated and they're trying to use some application to get some protected resources. So your application probably already exists and you want to add policy enforcement to that application. So if we were to decouple those policies from that application, we would get a policy decision point. So that's going to be all your logic that is involved with making the decision of whether something allowed is allowed or not. So your application is only concerned with describing the event that is happening and enforcing the results of your policy decision point. So a policy decision point by itself is pretty useless. I mean, you can put logic in it, but you need to manage it somehow. Someone needs to write the actual rules. So that's where your policy administration point comes in. So everything that falls under an administrator is trying to modify a policy, which has to be distributed to every policy decision point, counts as something that falls under the policy administration point. So finally, another critical part of this whole system is an audit log. So you do want to keep some kind of structured event log for like compliance purposes, but also for analysis of every decision that's made by your system. And finally, there is also a policy information point, which might not be there in every case. Basically, the idea here is that your policy enforcement point may not know everything there is to know about a user, for example, and you might want to consider that information when you're making policy decisions. So that's the role of your policy information point. They will provide additional attributes that the policy enforcement point cannot provide. But it's a bit complex to implement, and I'll get back to that later. So let's start discussing our favorite tool, Open Policy Agent. So Open Policy Agent is an example of such a policy decision point. So it's a general purpose policy engine. And it's a CNCF graduated open source project. So CNCF graduation is kind of a status that implies that there is a large group of people behind it. So you can really build on top of it. Only projects that have a proven track record, have an open governance model, etc., can apply for the CNCF graduation. So that's what made it an ideal building block for us as well. So you have a large ecosystem already out there that's building on top of OPA. So for application authorization, you have companies like Permit.io and Aserto integrating OPA and providing more general solutions for application authorization. You also have open source projects, a lot in the configuration validation space, actually, to validate policy against not access requests on application, but against resources in a piece of infrastructure. So a very common one here is Gatekeeper, which takes Open Policy Agent and uses it to make decisions against your infrastructure. For example, with Gatekeeper, you could say, I don't want to run any containers as root in my platform. And then Gatekeeper would validate all your configuration and block such resources from actually running. So there's a whole lot of things you can do with Open Policy Agent, not just application authorization. That's not in the slide, but there's also a company that I know of that's using Open Policy Agent for making decisions to determine whether a certain transaction is fraud or not. So you can go really far with this tool. This is all thanks to the Rego policy language, which I will introduce later in a practical demo. So OPA is easy to integrate in different ways, which I will cover right now. So the first method is probably the most common one out there. So that's running Open Policy Agent as a standalone binary next to your application on the same host. So this is universal, which is really interesting if you're working with Java, because Open Policy Agent is a Go project. You can't just import it as a Java library. The idea here is that you make an HTTP request from your application to your OPA instance and get a response there. So the latency there is actually quite okay because OPA itself doesn't call any external resources when it's making its decisions. So yeah, you're not crossing any network boundary there, just making requests to localhost. So if you're on Kubernetes, you might implement this using the sidecar pattern, or you can just ensure that the OPA server is always running on the same host in other ways. So the second method you have here is if you're using Golang, then you might also implement the OPA SDK, which is basically importing the entirety of OPA in your application and calling that. So it's roughly the same in terms of configuration as actually running the server, but it doesn't serve the full OPA API. So it's a bit more limited in management capabilities, and obviously you can only use Go. So yeah, that makes it not applicable to all situations. So the final one, which is kind of universal, is by calling the policy engine in a little bit more of a low-level way. So this gives you a high degree of control. If you're on other languages, you could compile your policy bundle to a WebAssembly module and execute that WebAssembly in any language that has a WebAssembly runtime. If you are using Go, you could also import Rego, so the lower level package from the Go repo, and directly call that. So the big downside of this is that you have to implement certain management features yourself. So in OPA, you can just give it like a place to refresh its policy from, and it will just work. If you do this, then you will have to build all that logic yourself. So to summarize things up a little bit, the OPA server is basically the best choice for all languages and a good place to start. If you use Golang, you might also consider the OPA SDK. It will make your deployment a little bit simpler. And if you really need the extra low-level control, you can also use WebAssembly modules or call the Rego library directly. So we've set up OPA, we've integrated it in our policy enforcement point, but we haven't distributed our policy yet. So we need to get our policy from our administrators to our policy decision points. So when we talk about policy distribution, we're talking about policy bundles. So policy bundles are technically really simple. They're just tar archives containing your Rego code and your extra data you might need inside your policy logic. So to distribute them, you have various options. And yeah, the good news here is that you already probably have one of these running in your infrastructure. So you might have an OCI registry already when you're running containers. Well, you can also just package up your policy bundle as an OCI image and push that to the same registry. Then you don't need to build any additional infrastructure to support this. But you can also use an object store like S3 to pull your policy bundles. And if you want to get really advanced, you can also implement the OPA bundle API, which is an API specified by OPA that you have to implement on your server to serve policy bundles. But those two first options work fine for pretty much almost all use cases. So whatever you do when you go to production with this, the most important thing is you want to keep a good eye on when your changes are rolling out, because some nodes might have issues loading your policy bundle for because network problems, because a version being out of date or something. So to do this, you could implement the OPA status API, which is kind of an endpoint you can implement somewhere that will be called whenever Open Policy Agent has an update. Or you could expose Prometheus metrics. So whatever you do, it's very important to track whether your bundle is actually rolling out correctly. So yeah, now you're replicating your bundle all over the place. You might start getting concerned about the integrity of the policy bundle as you do that. So OPA has got you covered there as well. So there's an OPA sign command that allows you to sign a policy bundle, which will give you a JWT that you can package into the bundle and which will be verified out of the box by a key that you configure in your OPA instance. So yeah, the key management itself here is kind of limited. So you can also implement a custom interface that OPA provides for extension to integrate it with your cloud key management solution, for example. If you're using OCI to distribute your policy bundles, you might be tempted to use the same thing you have for signing your container images. so something like a six-store cosine. But unfortunately, that's not supported out of the box, so OPA won't verify the signatures. So there's a bit more work to be done there. But OPA sign will work for most people. So the final aspect before I get into the demo is audit logging. So if you're using the OPA server or SDK, then you can tell it to log its events to the console or to a specific HTTP endpoint. So this is really useful for not only the obvious things like analysis and compliance, but also for replayability. Because your audit logs contain the full input that's being considered by your policy engine, and they also contain the bundle revision that these things were calculated with. So you can take a certain event that's happened, and you can put it locally, and you can rerun that event on your machine if you have the policy bundle, which is really, really valuable if you want to start debugging why something happened, or if you want to make changes to your policy and you want to make sure that those changes are correct. So yeah, I really recommend doing this and building tools around that. So we've implemented our PDP using OPA. We've seen how our policy administration points can fit in here to distribute policies. And we've collected decision logs. I didn't go over the pip in detail yet. That's an optional piece of the puzzle, which I will cover after the practical demo. So that's how the blocks are glued together. So before I continue, I want to make a small side note here. There are solutions in the ecosystem that cover some of the things I've said here. So you have Opal by permit.io, or you have commercial solutions like DAS by Styra, who are the authors of OPA, which implements some of these parts like policy distribution and audit logging and things like that. So yeah, the goal here is mostly that you know that how these things are built up, and then you can make an informed decision about whether to take a more full-featured solution or something more custom. So enough boring you with my slide deck, let's show something in action. So for this talk, I've written a small toy application in Go that integrates OPA, so I can demonstrate Rego policies a little bit. So let's drag over my VS Code window. And let's drag over my application window. Here we go. So on the left side, you can see a very basic application. Let me zoom into that. Oh, that's not necessary, I think. One zoom level, maybe. All right. So on the top, you can see the identity that I'm logged in as. So an identity in an ABAC system is a set of attributes, basically. And the same thing goes for the list of files here. These are all just fictional examples, completely bullshit, but just enough to get the point across. So all these files also have a bunch of attributes set to them on which I will be building some policies. So the application here in the backend is consists of a Go program serving this page, and then also a policy administration point that takes whatever I'm typing here, puts it into a policy bundle and loads it. So first of all, I'm going to write a very simple policy to allow staging data access for everyone. So to start, I'm going to say outc if, and then I'm going to open my block, and I'm going to check some attributes. So I'm going to check the input, which is the description of the event as described by the policy enforcement point. And I'm going to check resource attributes, and I'm going to check the environment attribute here, which should be equal to staging. So as you can see, yeah, defaults to false, but if this evaluates to true, then outc will become true, which is the variable that my application will query to determine this. So if I press F5 here, you can see that I suddenly have access to this file because it has the environment staging attribute here. So I can make a little bit more of a complex policy here to allow HR PII data in the same location. So I'm going to start by opening my rule, and I'm going to check the resource classification, which has to be equal to this string right here. And then I'm going to check my group as well. Otherwise, I will be allowing access to all data with this classification to just about anyone, which is not what we want to do. So I'm going to check input.subject.function, which has to equal HR. So if I were to apply this policy right now and see the result, I would get access to both of these files. So I can go ahead and put another location constraint on this. So I'm going to say input.subject.workingLocation has to equal, has to equal the resource location. And voila, we only have access to the file in Belgium because our current working location is Belgium. So finally, we can also access some data in our bundle during our policy evaluation. This is really useful if you have like an external application that's able to configure your policy bundle. So here I have a data.json file with like a kind of ACL that my policy bundle will consider in these specific scenarios. So if I were to make a rule using this file, I would start the same way, authorize if, and I would copy over that location check, and I would also copy over the classification check here. But change it to the other classification. By the way, this classification system is just purely fictional. And I'm going to check my data. So I'm going to check if my subject's email, subject.email, is in data dot, and then I'm going to go to my J file, data.customerDataAccess. So because I'm in this list, I will get access to this file. But if I were to remove myself from this list, this access would be revoked. So yeah, you might, when you're writing regular policies, be a little bit concerned about whether your policy is actually functioning as you want it to function. And for that, there is a very simple solution. So when you're writing software, what do you do when you have a function and you want to make sure that function is acting correctly as you expect it to? You write a unit test. And you can do the same thing for Rego. So I have a set of unit tests already prepared here, which consists of a certain input that I'm going to assume, and then an assertion on that input. So if this block evaluates to true, then my test will pass. So this is a completely random request, which I don't expect to be authorized. Here I have a request where I have also mocked my data source, and I also don't expect this to be authorized because my location is wrong. And finally, I have a request that is completely correct, so my location is correct, I'm in the mocked access list, and as you can see here, it asserts that OutC will pass. So if I were to run these tests, using the OPA test utility, you will see that it's evaluated all these rules and that it's passed. So if I were to go to my policy here and introduce a bug, so for example, I forgot to check the list here by commenting out this line. And if I run this test again, you will see that it's going to fail because some of the assertions are no longer correct. So that's how you can gain a little bit more confidence in actually making sure that your policy is behaving correctly. So, that's it for the practical demo. I will finish off with some small tips and tricks that might come in handy. So let me reopen my presentation here. Presenter view. All right. That's the previous slides. So, when you're writing your policies, you notice that I didn't make any rules to deny any action. So it might be very tempting to introduce this, and Rego is plenty powerful to actually do this. But yeah, I haven't done this with a very good reason. So in attribute-based access control, especially if you're working across different systems and you might not have all attributes available at the same time, it makes a lot more sense if you start from a baseline where nothing is allowed and you make policies for cases where your access would be allowed. So in other words, more attributes, which you check in your policy, means more access, which makes a lot more sense than if you say, the less attributes I have, the more access I have, which you would get if you made a policy, if this attribute is true, then deny this access. So if you do this, it's a lot less error prone. However, you can still implement this in Rego if you really want to, because yeah, Rego allows you to do a lot of things. I just showed off like very simple attribute evaluating policies, but you can get really fancy with this. I just didn't have the time to show all it. So another thing that you might want to do is storing your Rego code in Git. Just as we're writing unit tests, like with software, we can also store our Rego in Git, like with software. This gives you a free change history, like an administration audit log on your policy, basically. This gives you a CI flow that you already have for your software that you can also reuse for validating and testing your policy. So you can run these unit tests inside your CI. And you can also have an entire approval process for your policy changes, just in the same way as you make a pull request when you want to change some code. So yeah, it's really, really, really effective to store your Rego code in Git. So finally, you might want to start building policy authoring tools. So yeah, not everyone is going to be happy writing Rego code, and also your Rego code is not really readable for the entire audience that might be interested in reading your policy. So you could become more transparent if you, for example, make a Rego policy that considers most of its rules based on a data source, like the data.json file that I showed you during the demo. And on that data source, you can make a UI that writes that data.json to your policy bundle. And then you could take that UI and show it to people and allow them to make policy rules, which is going to improve your transparency towards your audience a little bit. What you also can do is you can make a UI to write the Rego code directly. So that's something we've actually done internally. So you have kind of a UI that allows you to click together different kinds of attribute evaluations. And then in the backend, it will write a policy. So it's definitely viable, but more complex. You can get infinitely complex with this, just like with any points I covered here during this presentation. But the idea is that the base system is also plenty usable. So you can get as complex as you need to. So yeah, I didn't cover the pip yet, which I will do now. So an example of a pip might be something like an LDAP directory containing some user information that your application doesn't have access to. Maybe your application only knows the user ID and your pip knows the rest about the user. So when you implement this, you want to consider some of these aspects. So one of them is that policy evaluation shouldn't have any side effects. So yeah, OPA provides you with the capability of sending HTTP requests from your policy itself, but that will trigger side effects in other systems and will really negatively impact your replayability of your policy, because you no longer have the full information required to reproduce these decisions. So another risk that you run here is you might have business logic leaking into your policy. For example, which URL do you request this information from? That might not be the same for every system that you deploy your policy on. So yeah, keep an eye on that also. Yeah, finally, latency impact is a pretty important one to consider here, because you're making external calls during your evaluation, which you normally wouldn't be making, so that's going to impact everything your application does. So there are generally two ways to implement a policy information point still. There are more, but yeah, these are the main ways. If your data has low frequency changes and fits in memory, then you can get away with basically having a data.json file that just contains everything. But yeah, if your dataset gets a little bit too large, then another approach that you might want to take is overloading your input documents. So this is a really fancy way for saying, hey, I have this input document, I am missing some information from this request, so I'm going to fill in that information from my policy information point, and then I'm going to take that request and put it in the policy engine. So that way, when you log your event, you still have all the information required to reproduce that event without having to also reproduce your network call that you're making. So that does make the situation a little bit better, but you still have to go to an external system. So yeah, this is also something we have done in practice. So yeah, you can get infinitely complex with this. Again, you can we basically have some kind of system that takes your input JSON, looks at your policy, sees what kind of attribute accesses are going on, and then we'll try to make a GraphQL query to query the backend to get this information. So you can get really mad with this, but you don't have to if you don't need to. Just as with anything. So let's wrap things up. So to do this, I'm gonna pull out my favorite slide once more. So if we want to do this for real, what do we do? Well, we start with our simple scenario again, where our end user is connecting to some application to get some protected resources. You're gonna want to ask yourself the question, what kind of applications are you working with? Are they lacking policy enforcement in some way? Because yeah, you need a problem before you make a solution. So if you found your problem, then you might want to ask yourself, what do your subjects and resources look like? So what's going to be the structure of your policy request? How do you describe who a person is? How do you describe what a resource looks like in a way that makes sense across your entire system? So if you've defined this, you can start by making a schema for your policy request that you can use to validate your policies against, for example. Then you might want to ask yourself the question, do you need a policy information point? If you can get away with it, with not having it, then you won't need it, but you may need it. And then you will have to ask yourself, how do you implement it? Is your data set large? Is it just a small piece of data that you have to consider in your policy? Things like that. So if you have all that, then you will ask yourself, how do you integrate your policy decision points? So all this counts for any solution really, but in this case it's probably going to be OPA. So are you going to put an OPA binary next to the application and deploy that everywhere, or are you going to use the more low-level methods? So finally, you want to consider who will read and write your policy. Because based on that, you will be writing your user interfaces if you need to write any user interfaces, for example. Or if it's just going to be developers, then you can get away with them having to write some Rego code and just committing that to Git directly. So yeah, that was it for my presentation. Thank you a lot for listening. This talk wouldn't be possible without the support of my awesome colleagues at Clario. So Clario is a systems integrator specialized in cloud-native data platforms. We're over 80 employees worldwide and hiring, so yeah, if you want to come and chat, come and say hello at booth number 31 to talk about the presentation, or just if you want to know more about Clario in general. And I see we still have a little bit of time left, so are there any questions? Go ahead. Yeah, so basically the way we started implementing this is, first of all, we created a small schema for our policy requests, which contains the entire structure of a thing. And then we just gave it to developers who can then write against that schema to make HTTP requests to our policy decision point endpoint. Policy decision point endpoints, yeah, that makes sense. But in general, yeah, this doesn't scale over time, and eventually we made some libraries in different programming languages like Java and Go and also TypeScript. to call the policy decision points from, which kind of streamlines the integration process a little bit. But you can start with just having an open API schema and telling your developers that that's the place where they make their requests. Go ahead. That's a good question, because Rego itself, like I showed you some very, very simple Rego code, but it can get quite complex and you have to make a certain click when you're structuring your policy. So yeah, not everyone immediately picks up on that. So that's why we made kind of a UI to click together these attributes, and in the backend it will output some Rego code. So yeah, making such a UI is of course a little bit of a challenge. So it kind of depends on how much how much time you have to write such a system, but yeah, you can make some workshops, for example, because yeah, Rego is really nice to learn, because yeah, you have things like the Rego Playground, for example, and in the Rego Playground you can write on one screen some Rego policy and on the other screen see the result of it, a little bit similar to my demo. So if you take that Rego Playground, you can make a small workshop around it, and then yeah, people will also get more hands-on with it. Ah, go ahead.
In the authorization part,
yeah.
Can be green or red, authorized or not. Is there any other state possible? So can you be authorized only if you do a two-factor authentication, or
yeah, so that's actually one of the reasons why we went with OPA in the first place, because it was so extensible. My application just queries the OutC variable, just a simple Boolean. But in OPA, you can also query anything that's defined in your policy. So what we've done in the past, for example, we've not only returned this OutC Boolean, but also returned a list of certain fields in the data that need to be filtered out when this resource is allowed to be requested. So yeah, that's definitely something you can do. You can get arbitrarily complex in the structure you return from your policy. So yeah, that's very dependent on your policy enforcement point. So your attributes are probably in some way linked directly into your database with the object that's being requested. Or yeah, worst case, your policy enforcement point has to do some extra lifting to get those attributes in there so that it can make a full policy request. So one of the things we've also done is like for Kafka, for example, we have like a system that integrates Kafka ACLs and Open Policy Agent. And we have some extra store that contains a mapping of Kafka topics and attributes. And we consider that mapping when we make our policy evaluation. Yeah, technically it's considered a pip, but in this case, the component that's making the ACLs has that information already, so it's something in between, pretty much. All right, go ahead. That's a good point, because yeah, currently, as we've done it, you basically at one point see that your request is denied, and then you have to go around and yeah, get someone to query the audit logs to see what's happened on the system, to see what policy is causing this problem. So yeah, it's always a communication with developers, and getting information out is always a challenge. All right, if there are no more questions, or if you have a question that comes up later, you can always stop by the booth and we can still talk about it. Thank you for listening.